And we will open the hearing on House Bill 656. Are there any current sponsors of House Bill 656 in the audience today? Thank you. Please, I'll let you open up afterwards if you remember to fill out a pink card. I'll let you begin testimony after the bill.
All right.
Speak first. I'll let you introduce that. After you speak, please start.
Just recording the proceedings.
Yeah. That's somebody who's trying to check me
out. Okay. I remind you, please be quiet. We're having a speaker introduction in the building. Please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, committee members. I brought this bill forward because I've seen the impact that it's had on people's lives, whether it be decrim or legalization. I'd be more happy with legalization, but this is really putting a hurt on people. You've heard testimony on the other bills that there are a majority that are in favor of decriminalization and legalization. I'd like to tell you a little bit about how this bill came together. In January 2014, the House voted to overturn an ITL on 492, a bill that would have legalized, taxed, and regulated marijuana. The bill was then narrowly voted ought to pass on the House floor and referred to Ways and Means. The Ways and Means Committee held a lengthy hearing on the issue and submitted a subcommittee, which included Mr. Chairman Separato, was killed and returned to the House floor. For a brief overview, possession of 1 ounce or less will become legal for adults 21 or older. Cultivation of up to 6 plants, of which 3 could be mature, would become legal. There are 4 types of marijuana establishments that would be licensed under HB 492, marijuana cultivation facilities, marijuana testing facilities, marijuana product manufacturing facilities, and retail marijuana stores. Marijuana cultivation facilities would be licensed and regulated by the Department of Agriculture. Marijuana testing and facilities would be product manufacturers' facilities would be licensed and regulated by DHHS. Retail marijuana stores would be licensed and regulated by the Liquor Commission. Municipalities would be allowed to limit or prohibit the number of types of establishments. The most significant changes to this bill before introducing the tax rate, where the tax money goes, in this version, $30 an ounce, leading the cultivation facility, and 15 at retail. Additionally, 70% of revenues would go into the general fund, distributed to the cities and towns for the purpose of property tax relief, which I feel is long overdue. So we're killing 2 birds with 1 stone here. This bill would also set up a mechanism for industrial hemp to be regulated by the Department of Agriculture. Thank you for considering this bill. If you have any questions, I do my best to answer them. But I would like to say, I had 2 comments, if I may, about the previous bill. Is that all right?
Sorry, please, sure.
Thank you. I believe it was the gentleman on the end, Representative, I don't know if I can read your name from here. Yes, sir.
Gagney.
You, I'm sorry?
Gagney.
Thank you, sir. You had asked about a street-side marijuana test. I recently...
I
apologize.
Yes, sir.
All right, well, then it was your question, sir, but the answer's still the same. They are working on one, and it is almost ready. Not for prime time, but at least for testing. So that has come a long way. And another point I'd like to make, which could be applied to both bills, is I've also read that the FBI is having a hard time finding high-tech people to run their computers and stuff like that, because the vast majority of them pop positive for marijuana. So they are actually considering not making that one of the requirements so they can get good people in the FBI. And with that, we have to take any questions.
Hey, questions of the committee? Seeing none, thank you. I'm sorry, Representative Geyer.
What would you think the impact would be on more people not passing drug tests?
Well, thank you for the question. I'm not really sure about that. It would be up to the employer. I mean, employers don't test for alcohol, but it would be up to them if they certainly could. I would think that it would be less likely that they would not hire them because it's a legal thing. You know, you can smoke a cigarette. They may force you to go outside, but there are some places that won't hire you if you smoke, and it would be the same situation there. Property owners' rights or the employers' rights.
Further questions to the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Testimony.
Thank you.
Chair calls Susan Kewen, speaking in opposition to the bill. I remind the sponsor to please turn in a pink card for the clerk.
Thank you, Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Susan McKeown and I'm from Manchester. I've been a pediatric nurse practitioner for 41 years, a certified prevention specialist, a facilitator for the Manchester parent group that deals with families with substance misuse issues, and family support coordinator helping to set up and establish 17 groups around the state dealing with the issues of substance use with families, an author and a parent. I share that brief resume with you just to show that I have had a long and broad exposure to this issue. My focus today is on timing. Honored to be named the Prevention Person of the Year in 2015, I take prevention very seriously and very passionately about it. We have made some good strides with prevention. I refer you to the YRBS, the Youth Behavioral Survey, or the Monitoring the Future done by NIDA, the National Institute of Drug Abuse. And both of them have shown that in 2015, we have shown some significant decrease in the use of cannabis by 8th and 10th graders, stabilization with 12th graders. I think that's interesting, the fact that it does show that we are starting to make some progress with our prevention work. We are far from done on that. It has really got a lot of work to do with prevention. We know that with legalization, that there is increased availability and a decrease in the perception of harm. With that, we can expect that there will be, as has been shown by other states, Colorado being the most recent, that have legalized, and the one for which we have the most, the only recent research on, that there, we can expect that there's going to be an increased use of cannabis with legalization by our young people. Even though we intended to be over 21, we do learn from experience. With that, we have to look at what are the ramifications of that drug use and how prepared are we to deal with it. If we look at our current situation with opiate drug use, we know that we are not at the point where we have established a protocol with that. Protocol is the word that I want to mention, and it is in my testimony to you. We all know what protocol is. I certainly work with it as a nurse practitioner. But you know what it is just from a patient point of view. If you go in with a problem, we'll use diabetes as an example, there's certain things that you know are going to happen. You're going to be weighed, you're going to have your blood pressure taken, you're going to be referred to lab testing, you're going to have a visit with a nutritionist. nutritionist, perhaps an endocrinologist, maybe on medication. There will be follow-up if you fall off your diet. They'll get you on an exercise program. There's a whole bunch of things that are going to happen. This is true of every chronic relapsing illness, except with substance use. We're not there yet. We do not have solid prevention. As I said, we're making some success in that way, but we don't have it yet. We don't have universal screening in primary care and in emergency rooms. We don't have the appropriate evaluations always available or the treatment that may be appropriate for the person. And our recovery systems, making great strides here in the state, are not all in place yet. So it's that protocol that we do not have. And that's why I mentioned timing, okay? It's premature to legalize yet another substance where we do not have the capacity yet to deal with the ramifications of it. Thank you very much. Are there any questions?
Questions of the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Chair calls Dennis Goddard to speak in support of the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. My name is Dennis Goddard. I'm from Hopkinton, speaking solely for myself, and I appreciate that you've been hearing about marijuana all day, so I'll try and be quick about this. I know some folks have come to you, you know, and talked to you about a concern that we're losing people to places like Massachusetts or California that may be more favorable legalization-wise. I know that you've also heard from folks today that there are concerns about our young folks and what's going to happen if they're going to intersect with marijuana and what sort of effect this is going to have on society and on these people, what kind of a message we're going to send. So I want to take literally 1 minute of time to tell you a true little story about me. And this is the honest truth. I moved from the Bay Area of California to New Hampshire because of the legislative environment, live free or die, no income tax, no seatbelt law, no sale. Great. That's why I chose to move here and not be in the Bay Area. I will also tell you that, relevant to the second thing that people have told you, when I was in high school, I did discover marijuana. I also discovered alcohol. I didn't like it very much because when you started to feel good on alcohol, it made you sick and you could even throw up. That was no fun at all. At any rate, I did get accepted to college. I continued using marijuana in college, by the way. I got accepted to the University of Wisconsin at Madison. I was in the chemical engineering program. I ended up doing a double major also in the arts of the College of Letters and Sciences with a computer science degree as well. I certainly found that a lot more folks in the computer area were using marijuana in college than were in the chemical engineering area, but there was a pretty good fraction in both. I certainly continued to use marijuana fairly heavily in college while I was learning about artificial intelligence and reactor design. The sort of skills that when it was time to graduate, it was fairly easy to land a job in the Bay Area during the dot-com boom when they were really looking for people with those kinds of skills, and I could pretty much decide where on earth I wanted to live. And then the internet happened, and now I really can live anywhere on planet Earth that has Wi-Fi, because that's all that my job needs. And the fact that I'm now a car-carrying patient, unfortunately, because really the benefits do not outweigh the minuses, but now that I do use marijuana legally in this state, I do wish some of the other folks that I work with in oppressed, overtaxed California had the opportunity to come here and live the way free people can. So please do consider legalizing marijuana. Thank you.
Thank you, testimony. Questions in the committee?
I'll take any questions, of course.
Thank you. Chair will call the Honorable George Lambert.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I testified on the previous bill. You probably remember that. So, to save you all time, I'm going to say ditto and turn back here. But I have some more entertaining information for you. This is a graph. Can you see this graph? This graph is on NHPR, and this graph shows the drug deaths in New Hampshire for the last few years. Do you see the graph going up? You see that? I'll give you a copy if you want it. This is a different chart. This shows you how the people in those charts died. It's got fentanyl alone, fentanyl in combination with another drug other than heroin, heroin alone, heroin in combination with other substances, heroin and fentanyl combined, all other opioids, and total drug deaths. You know what isn't here? Not a single one of these little people representing groups who died is on here because of marijuana. Now I remember when Colorado passed decriminalization and then legalization, everyone suggested the wheels were going to come off. It was going to be the end of civilized culture in Colorado. The biggest problem I have heard in Colorado was how was the state going to collect their tax revenue when the medical marijuana or the consumer marijuana sales agencies couldn't open bank accounts because of the feds, so they were having to pay their taxes in cash. And these places had too much cash on hand that was creating problems for the police because they didn't want them to be robbed. Those are the problems that have come to Colorado. Good problems, in that the people didn't go out and have mass deaths. There was no mass killing. There was no crisis. There were people who were happy to have access, and nobody died that I know of. We can ask the room. I'm willing to turn around. Has anyone heard of someone dying in Colorado from marijuana?
No.
Direct testimony to the chair, please.
Sorry. Thank you. I wanted to check. Nobody else in the room seems to think there were any deaths either. I figured the opposition would have something. This is not about death. This is not about safety. This is about government policy and the way the public feels about the laws by which they are now regulated. It is time for New Hampshire to demonstrate that we are the live free or die state and not let Maine or Massachusetts compete for our title. Thank you very much. I'll take any questions.
Seeing no questions of the committee, thank you. Testimony?
Would anyone like the pictures of those graphs, or did they make the point? Anyone want the pictures? Okay.
Chair calls Kate Frey to speak in opposition to the bill.
Again, my name is Kate Fry. I'm the Vice President of Advocacy at New Futures. We are here today in opposition to House Bill 656. This bill is about the legalization of marijuana, not decriminalization. Legalization means that all components of the marijuana business process will be legal. This type of legislation will enable and promote the development of a commercial marijuana enterprise in New Hampshire. This enterprise would include an active network of growers, manufacturers, distributors, retail establishments selling high-potency marijuana-based oils, edible products, such as marijuana-infused candy and baked goods, all operating with a profit motive and the incentive to increase consumption by marketing to create new users and maintain new users. Think big tobacco, big alcohol, and corporate enterprise. New Futures strongly opposes House Bill 656 relative to the legalization of marijuana and the regulation of it because of the grave implications to our youth, negative impacts to public health and public safety, and a threat to New Hampshire's quality of life. These values are big trade-offs for a possibility of limited revenue. So you've heard that there's really been no issues in Colorado, and I have some information to present that different view of that. I will leave a full report with you from the Colorado HIA that produces quarterly reports of what's happening since legalization. Access to marijuana, as we've seen in Colorado, will increase youth use, and negative implications will follow. It's proven that the more available marijuana is, the number of youth users will increase, as will with problems with excessive use. Colorado has seen a drastic increase in youth use following legalization. There was a 20% increase compared to the two-year average prior to legalization. You'll hear another report where actually those rates came down. That information is not correct, and I have an article that will back up the numbers that I presented to you. Youth have ranked number one in the nation for past month marijuana use, up from four before. Colorado's past month marijuana use in 2013-2014 was 74% higher than before legalization. Let's talk public health and safety. Colorado has seen negative public health and safety outcomes affecting their state since legalization. 49% increase in the number of marijuana-related emergency room visits, much due to marijuana-infused product poisonings. Marijuana-only-related exposures increased 155% in the three-year average since Colorado legalized marijuana. There's been a 62% increase in marijuana-related traffic deaths after recreational marijuana was legalized in 2013. You'll also often hear proponents of legalization stress that these efforts will eliminate the black market. However, Highway Patrol yearly interdiction seizures in Colorado increased 37% since recreational marijuana was legalized. So let's talk about the revenue. The supporters of legalization believe the state will gain a windfall of revenue due to legalization. However, Colorado annual tax revenue from the sale of recreation and medical marijuana was only about 5.5% of Colorado's total state budget. While taxpayers in Colorado were promised marijuana revenue would replace the income tax or fill holes in education and other services that have been cut over years, those promises have not come to fruition. New Hampshire still does not correctly allocate profits from the sales of liquor for prevention, treatment, and recovery 13 years after Alcohol Fund was created. Passing House Bill 656 will put us in a similar situation with yet another harmful substance. So in closing, I just want to leave you with this last visual. As of January 2016, there were 424 retail marijuana stores in the state of Colorado, compared to 322 Starbucks and 202 McDonald's. Is that what we want for New Hampshire? We're in a situation where we can wait and see what happens in other states that have made steps towards legalizing. Let's do what is right for New Hampshire and avoid other states' missteps and mistakes. We urge this committee to vote ITL on House Bill 656.
Questions to the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Chair will call Matt Simon to speak in favor of the bill. Also a reminder, does anyone else wish to speak? Please put your pink cards forward. I have both opposition. I don't have anything in opposition, but there are lots here in support. If we have you on either side of this, please come up and turn in a pink card.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I managed to not drop the mic this time. For the record, Matt Simon, Marijuana Policy Project, in support of the bill. And I often feel sorry for legislative committees that have to try to wrap their heads around this entire issue in one short hearing. This is a complex issue. It affects criminal justice, economic development, tax policy, public health, public safety, civil liberties, the environment, I could probably go on and on, education, certainly. But since I only have 3 minutes, or I'm only going to take 3 minutes, I'm giving you a lot of paper, and the paper has a lot of citations on it. Last year, I spent the session in Vermont and worked with the Senate Judiciary Committee, which actually spent 3 weeks on a bill just like this. They had hearings every day for 3 weeks. They took phone testimony from experts in Colorado and Washington, and they did a really deep dive into the issue. And if there's one document that came up again and again, I'm going to go off script here a little bit. I'm going to talk about the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area Report. In Vermont, virtually every opponent of legalization cited the executive summary of these reports. As the previous speaker mentioned, they're published, or I think there have been four of them since legalization in Colorado. And they often come across as, this is a law enforcement agency in Colorado, they say the sky has fallen, therefore we shouldn't be talking about legalization. In reality, the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area is a federally funded law enforcement agency. It's organized under the Office of National Drug Control Policy. And one of the handouts there explains that the Office of National Drug Control Policy, that's the Drug Czar's office, is actually forbidden by federal law. They are required to oppose the legalization of any Schedule I substance. So as long as marijuana is in Schedule I, the Office of National Drug Control Policy is required by law to oppose it and to take actions to oppose it. And in this case, I think their action has been the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area puts out these bogus reports, and they are, upon close examination, it becomes clear that there are many, many flaws with these reports. John Hudak from the Brookings Institution called the reports garbage. I've given you two handouts on the report. One of them looks at, and the mechanism. I was an English professor, and I taught rhetoric before I got into this deal, and I taught my students to evaluate what propaganda is and is not. And this is a classic case of government propaganda. If you read the executive summary, which is what most people read, they read the front page, these are the highlights, and you hear those scary statistics. I know they show up in your inboxes all the time. People forward them to me, I see them. Blows my mind. And if you really look, many of the times the quotes in the executive summary are explained away by their own footnote on page 42. But nobody reads the footnote on page 42. So there is a two-page handout that looks at some of those examples specifically. I would caution you that any statistic that comes to you from the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area, that you evaluate that very closely and look at what the actual people, your counterparts and others in the state of Colorado, not the feds, but the Colorado Department of Public Health, which does, for example, a much more comprehensive and larger survey of teen use, and reported this summer that teen use has declined slightly since Colorado legalized marijuana. Now, I present you with that study, and I present you with the YRBS study that shows an increase. There are three studies. Don't believe just one. This is a complex set of issues. There's data coming at you from every direction. But what isn't confusing? Prohibition hasn't worked. If it had worked, we wouldn't be here. If it had worked, 60%+ of grandstanders would not be ready to treat marijuana like alcohol. This is an opportunity to shift hundreds of millions of dollars away from illicit drug dealers who are currently the beneficiaries of prohibition and shift that into a regulated market. A regulated market that would employ young grandstanders who wouldn't have to move to Colorado and Washington. A regulated market that would produce tax revenue that would allow the state to do a much more better and more proactive job of educating young people about substances, of funding drug treatment. So, please consider this issue, and if you feel as a committee that you're not able to complete your work on this bill, and if you instead wanted to spend some time studying it this summer and fall, I imagine that a lot of people in this room would be interested in being part of that. But thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer questions.
Thank you, testimony. Questions of the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Chair calls Meredith Cook.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Meredith Cook. I am the director of the Office of Public Policy for the Roman Catholic Diocese of Manchester, and on behalf of Bishop Labashi and the ministries of the diocese, I'm here to oppose House Bill 656. In light of the length of your day and the excellent testimony already provided in opposition to this bill, especially by New Futures, I'm instead going to give you a copy of my testimony and rely upon that. Simply want to let you know that we have, as I mentioned earlier on an earlier bill, we take a position on this bill because we teach that the use of drugs inflicts a very grave damage on human health and life, and we urge you to report House Bill 656 as an expedient to legislate.
Thank you for your brevity. Any questions from the committee? See none, thank you. The chair calls Richard Van Wickler, and we remind that we ran quite a bit over the committee time, so again, if you keep your comments brief and try not to be redundant, the chair would appreciate it.
Mr. Chairman, honorable committee, thank you very much for the opportunity to testify here today. My name is Richard Van Wickler. I'm a lifelong resident of the state of New Hampshire. I'm currently the superintendent of the Cheshire County Department of Corrections in Keene. I've held that position since 1993. I've been in New Hampshire law enforcement for 29 years. I'm also a retired Army veteran of 26 years. I retired in 2006 from the Army. I'm here today representing Law Enforcement Action Partnership. This is a nonprofit organization that consists of undercover narcotics officers who are retired, state troopers, members of the DEA, the United States Marshals, judges, and law enforcement officers, prosecutors, who all believe that our current policy in the war on drugs is a failed policy and that we need immediate reform. As America continues to refine this country's laws on the use of marijuana, it's important that in the process we call attention to the significance and the acknowledgement of how these laws are going to affect the current situation of police and community relations, the safety of our communities, the protection of our children, the safety of law enforcement officers and their suspects, police corruption and misconduct, creating and financing crime, and of course, the treatment and prevention of drug or substance abuse. I support House Bill 656. My position is that marijuana should be legalized for recreational use, and that it should be closely regulated, taxed, and monitored in the same way that alcohol and tobacco is regulated. Here's what our current laws do not accomplish. They're not a deterrent to use. Current laws encourage illegal activity. It strengthens illegal cartels. It increases violence in our communities. It contributes to law enforcement corruption. It incarcerates nonviolent citizens. It significantly wastes public resources. It puts our children at risk, and it encourages them to use. Current marijuana prohibition laws provide a contaminated product to innocent people. Current marijuana prohibition laws encourage false propaganda, which erodes the trust of law enforcement and public officials. A responsible legislative committee that seeks to learn more about these facts and finally advance the results of studies or this particular bill in the form of acceptable law is encouraging. Education and treatment has a far better outcome than incarceration. Perhaps the most addictive substance we know of is tobacco in the form of cigarette smoking. In 1985, 42% of the population smoked cigarettes. Today, 17% of the population smoke cigarettes. This remarkable achievement did not require law enforcement or military intervention. It could only occur through a legalized market and strict regulation combined with education and social reform. Current marijuana laws, ladies and gentlemen, are not about public safety. According to the National Institute of Health, Obesity kills 300,000 people per year. It is the second leading cause of preventable death in the United States, followed by tobacco. There is no known case of anyone dying from marijuana, ever. One of the most challenging things for me to come to understand, and I'm sure that some of you grapple with it as well, is that drug laws, when we pass these advocacy for drug laws, it's not an advocacy for use. This is a really important place for me to come to realize over the years, and I know it is for you too. Advocacy for reform is not advocacy for use. We don't have liquor laws encouraging people to drink. We don't have tobacco regulation encouraging people to smoke. We are managing something that otherwise, if we don't manage it, is unmanageable and out of control. This is what I believe the common ground is in our discussion today. We do not advocate the use of any substance, whether it be alcohol, tobacco, marijuana, or any other illicit mind-altering substance. We believe that the use of these substances can be harmful, or they might even have ramifications due to their use. Marijuana is now legal in 8 states, in addition to Washington, D.C. We've legalized medicinal marijuana in 22 states as of July 2014. It's time that we stop passing and enforcing laws based on misinformation and propaganda, and finally act on what is right for our children, our families, and our community. Included, I'm going to provide 2 copies of my testimony today, and there are some facts in here that I'm hoping you will take a moment to look at. One of them is a report from the Center of the Juvenile and Criminal Justice Research Project. This was done in 2014. It was an intensive study on the 5 states at the time that had legalized marijuana, and that was California, Connecticut, Massachusetts, Colorado, and Washington. Here's 4 bullet points that resulted from the Center on Juvenile and Criminal Justice. Policymakers, researchers, and law enforcement are beginning to recognize that arresting and incarcerating people for marijuana possession wastes billions of dollars. It does not reduce the abuse of marijuana or other drugs, and results in grossly disproportionate harms to communities of color. Secondly, currently people under the age of 21 make up less than 1/3 of the marijuana users, but yet half of all marijuana possession arrests. That means that we're arresting our kids because of current law. Arguments to continue prohibition state that such laws are to protect our youth. If the consequences of arrest for marijuana possession include fines, jail time, community service, a criminal record, loss of student loans, and court costs, it seems clear that this is far more harmful than the mere use of the drug itself. Their 4th bullet statement: states with marijuana decriminalization has not resulted in harmful consequences for teenagers, such as increased crime, drug overdose, driving under the influence, or school dropout. In fact, California teenagers showed improvement in all risk areas after reform. Racial disparities, however, not only remained, but were exacerbated. African Americans are still more likely to be arrested for marijuana offenses after reform than all other races and ethnicities were before the reform. Their conclusion is that further reforms are needed in all 5 states to move toward full legalization and to address racial disparities. There is no evidence of harm resulting from the legalization of marijuana. I know that you've heard that marijuana is a gateway drug, because I've been at those hearings where police have testified to that. In fact, there is no study that suggests that it is. As a matter of fact, the association between early teen marijuana use and young adult abuse of other drugs fades from statistical significance with adjustments for stress and life course variables. That was from the Journal of Health and Social Behavior. peer groups and social interactions play a more significant role in gateway theorem than does the use of marijuana. Acquiring and using marijuana regularly in an illegal market may lead to association with peers who are pro-drug beyond marijuana. Those peers will include people who sell other drugs, reducing the difficulty of locating potential supplies. Legalization is likely then to reduce the incident of moving on to harder drugs when compared to the current situation. That according to the Drug Policy Research Center. There is no legitimate scientific study which concludes that the use of marijuana will certainly lead to harder drugs. The paper that I will give you, and in the interest of time, Mr. Chairman and Honorable Committee, is not to go over all of these statistics, but I do want to highlight, if you read this paper, what you'll hear about. You'll read about how many marijuana arrests there were in the United States, how many of those people just possessing marijuana were incarcerated, which is significant, how many people actually use. And I'm actually going to share that statistic with you. As you know, we have the largest prison system, jail system on planet Earth. We have 5% of the world's population. We have 25% of the world's inmates. That equates to 2.7 million people behind bars for all crimes. Our current position is to arrest people for this behavior. Well, in 2012, marijuana was the most commonly used illicit drug by Americans. There were 18.9 million users. 18.9 million. 8.9 million other users included all other illicit drugs. So the marijuana graph is quite higher than all other drugs combined. I'll tell you how often they use it in this paper. And I close with the comment from the Global Commission on Drug Policy that was chaired by George Shultz in 2011. He's the former Secretary of State for the United States. On that committee, there were 19 dignitaries from around the world. They released this report to the United States government as well as the public at large. I'd like to share just a piece of that with you to end my statement here today. They said, end the criminalization, marginalization, and stigmatization of people who use drugs but do no harm to others. Challenge rather than reinforce common misconceptions about drug markets, drug use, and drug dependence. Encourage experimentation by governments with models of legal regulation of drugs to undermine the power of organized crime and safeguard the health and security of their citizens. Offer health treatment services to those in need, ensuring that a variety of treatment modalities are available. Abolish abusive practices carried out in the name of treatment, such as forced detention, forced labor, and physical and psychological abuse, that contravene human rights standards and norms, or that remove the right to self-determination. Arresting and incarcerating tens of millions of these people in recent decades have filled prisons and destroyed lives and families without reducing the availability of illicit drugs or the power of criminal organizations. There appears to be no limit to the number of people willing to engage in this behavior to better their lives, provide for their families, or otherwise escape poverty. Drug control resources are better directed elsewhere. Invest in activities that can both prevent young people from taking drugs in the first place and also prevent those who do use drugs from developing more serious problems. The most successful prevention efforts may be those targeted at specific risk groups. Law enforcement efforts should focus not on reducing drug markets per se, but rather on reducing their harms to individuals, communities, and national security. Replacing drug policies and strategies driven by ideology and political convenience with fiscally responsible policies and strategies grounded in science, health, security, and human rights, and adopt appropriate criteria for their evaluation. review the scheduling of drugs that has been the result of obvious anomalies like flawed categorization of cannabis and other drugs. They end with break the taboo on debate and reform. The time for action is now. I have testified many times before the House and Senate over several years on this issue, and today, more than ever, as a citizen, I appreciate the job that you have. Subject to any questions you might have, Mr. Chairman, that concludes my testimony.
Questions of the committee? Seeing none, thank you for your testimony. Chair calls Roger Tilton. I'd remind that we also have quite a few cards here. We've got numerous times ranging from anywhere from 7 minutes to less. I'd really ask that you be brief to make sure that we get everybody in to speak, and while the committee is still here, please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I won't repeat anything that I spoke about earlier when I talked about demographics and polling and reasons to try to keep young people in our state. Instead, I'll tell you my personal story from a business standpoint. 50 weeks ago, it was the second week of February, I went to the cannabis convention in Seattle, Washington, where 238 businesses were exhibiting their wares, everything from soils and seeds and fertilizers and grow pots and planting techniques and processing techniques and machines to do all of these things. 238 exhibitors. Three of the exhibitors were law firms. And my partner and I were standing talking to one of the attorneys, and his partner, the other attorney, came up behind us and stood behind us and said, "You three people are breaking the law. You could all go to jail for 20 years, Title 19, that's RICO, that's racketeering. You are conspiring to violate federal law and promote an illegal industry." At that moment, I started laughing. The light bulb went off. I thought, they can't arrest the 3,200 people that are in this room, and they can't shut down every business that's here. One of the businesses was from Germany, and they make a machine that will take a kilogram of marijuana plant up on top, put it in the machine, and then 28 minutes later, out at the bottom, you'll get your wax, your paste, and your oil, and that's what they use in the new vaporizing agents that allow you to experience cannabis without smoking it. It allows for the substances that go into the edibles, the sprays, the tinctures, and the oils. So this is an industry that's here to stay. And it was at that moment that I knew I was going to quit my job and get into that industry. So in April of last year, I did quit my job. 28 years on Wall Street as a financial advisor, helping people and businesses find investors and investments. Now I do that in the cannabis industry, and I have been for the last 9 months. I went to the Cannabis Business Expo and Convention, the fifth annual in Las Vegas, the week after the election. 12,000 people paid $400 just to go into the convention floor. That's the largest crowd they've ever had. More than 350 companies were there promoting their products. This industry is not going away. We had an opportunity years ago to be first in the nation, but we were timid. We were scared. We were afraid of what Franklin Roosevelt told us not to be afraid of, which is fear itself. There shouldn't be fear in this industry. This is a natural plant. It's creating tens of thousands of jobs, which will be hundreds of thousands of jobs in the near future. Just in the last 9 months, my little investment company has secured either cash or commitments of $4.7 million to invest in 9 different startups in the legal cannabis industry in the state of Washington. Unfortunately, I have to commute to the state of Washington to do this work because we haven't yet legalized it here. The other aspect besides jobs,
keeping young people in the state, is really the economics of it. We're sitting on an economic powder keg, and we just keep sitting on it. My question is, how long are we going to do that? How many more states are going to legalize, regulate, and tax cannabis before New Hampshire? Just doing thumbnail back envelope math, a very conservative estimate, using the state of Washington 24% tax model, we can expect $20 to $40 million of revenue per year just based on sales. And as I said earlier about the economic impact, if we just decriminalize, would be substantial on the resources of our prisons, courts, police, detectives, et cetera, et cetera. So I would ask you to look at more than just what cannabis might mean to you, what your experience might be, and look at what the other states are doing, look at what the country's doing, and look at where the people are. As I've said, oftentimes, your constituents get way out ahead of you. There's not going to be a backlash if you vote for this bill. I stand in support. Thanks for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. Questions of the committee? Seeing none, Chair will call Susan Duncan to speak in opposition. And again, each time you listen to times to be speaking on this, 3 minutes, we've yet to have someone stick to their time and their card. If you do, the Chair would most appreciate it.
Mr. Chairman and members of the committee, for the record, I'm Susan Duncan. I'm not an expert. I don't represent anybody. But the Senate did pay me to sit and listen to hearings for 22 years, and I came away with a number of observations. I have never in 22 years of Senate hearings heard anybody come in and hold Massachusetts up as an example we should be following. No one ever came in and said, I want mandatory seatbelts because Massachusetts has it. Nobody ever came in and said, I want mandatory motorcycle helmets because Massachusetts has it. And I guarantee you nobody ever said I want an income tax because Massachusetts has it. So the fact that they live next door to us and many of our citizens left there to move and work here is not an example to follow. What I think they made is a great mistake. This current push is exactly like the tobacco industry did when I was growing up. And I grew up in North Carolina, where tobacco was king. If your family had to harvest the tobacco, that was an excused absence for kids in school to stay home and help pick tobacco. The first time I flew on an airplane, tobacco cigarettes were handed out for free because they were determined to get you hooked. And it took us years and years and years to stand up and look at how we were poisoning ourselves in our society, and we did the same thing with alcohol. There are three kids in my family. My daddy was a minister, my mother was a child welfare worker. I have one beer on Friday night to celebrate. I survived another week at work. My older brother, thank God, is a sober alcoholic. We grew up with the same DNA, the same family. We never had alcohol in our family. There is something innate within a human being that you do not know until you try a substance whether you're going to be addicted or not. And I believe with every fiber of my being that marijuana is no different. God bless people who can use a product safely in the privacy of their home and it is not a problem. But that is not everyone. We heard back when we had the task force on the drug and alcohol of the drug crisis, 2 years ago, we had a young man who came in and he testified eloquently. And he said for him, marijuana was a gateway drug. He ended up addicted to heroin and he was clean and he was going off to college that year. But he said, I started with pot. And for him, it was an addiction. we have got to be very careful. I spent last weekend and I read the report that's come out on DCYF and the crisis we're having in the welfare department here. There are three major issues that are affecting the ability to keep social workers, the court cases, substance abuse, domestic violence, mental illness. And the tragic part is for very few of these is it single. For many, these are co-occurring. They are having substance abuse and domestic violence, substance abuse and mental health issues. And it just compounds our ability to help. Right now in this state, we are paying dearly to deal with the drug crisis. We have lost nearly 500 citizens. This is impacting our families, our courts, DCYF, our schools, our churches, every institution we have, we are paying. This bill is the death of common sense. We are in a drug crisis. You do not take another drug and make it legal because you do send the message that it's okay. One of the women earlier accidentally used the word discrimination, that this bill, the prior bill, discriminated against our youth. It's not discrimination, it's protection. That is my job. As a mother, as a grandmother of four precious children, it is my job to help my grandchildren grow up. We have proven statistically that the longer you can help a young person from experimenting with tobacco, alcohol, or drugs, the less likely they are to become addicted. We have got to deal with what we're the costs of addiction right now, but we've got to prevent it because we'll never treat our way out of it. We have got to prevent the next wave from coming in. Please kill this bill. Thank you.
No questions from the committee? Seeing none, we'll call Anna Brown to speak in support of the bill. Is Anna Brown here? Thank you. Take 2 minutes, so we'll see if you can stick to it. I will start to remind everyone of the time to make sure we can get through the stack of cards. This rate will be done by about 8:30 tonight.
So on January 26th, we asked on Facebook, should New Hampshire legalize the recreational use of marijuana? Using Facebook tools, we isolated comments from New Hampshire, and we summarized those responses as a form of citizen testimony. Over 2,000 New Hampshire people participated in our discussion. It was one of our most popular topics. And a huge majority, a vast majority of about 94% supported marijuana legalization. So packets I passed out have all the comments we received from citizens and more information about our process, but I'm also happy to answer questions now.
Thank you. I have a question. When was this survey conducted?
So it's not a survey. It's we accept comments from the public through our website and Facebook. So it's a little bit like an online hearing in that the people who are passionate about the issue are the people who are going to choose to comment.
When was the time?
January 26th.
Thank you. Any questions of the committee? Now, thank you. Thank you for your brevity, too.
That's 2 minutes. Time.
Chair will call Dan Goodman. It's Goodman, Portland, Maine. And again, you've indicated 3 minutes. Thank you.
Hello. Is this close enough? Yes, can you hear me? All right, my name is Dan Goodman. I'm a public affairs manager for AAA Northern New England. We represent about 407,000 members currently in New Hampshire. I'm here to oppose this bill. Driving is a complex task, and we are concerned that by legalizing marijuana, this will pose a very serious threat to the safety of New Hampshire roads. Last year, the AAA Foundation for Traffic Safety released two really important research projects. They went to Washington State, which legalized the drug in 2012, and the percentage of drivers in fatal crashes who had recently used marijuana more than doubled from 8% to 17%. This means that 1 in 6 drivers involved in fatal crashes tested positive for THC. The report also found that after alcohol, cannabis is the most common drug found in drivers who have been involved in traffic crashes. Another report they released, in an attempt to enforce drug-impaired driving, some states have created legal limits, also known as per se limits, which specify the maximum amount of active THC that drivers can have in their system based on a blood test. THC is the main chemical component in marijuana that can impair driver performance and affect the mind and the presence, the THC generally suggests of recent marijuana use. The per se limits are kind of similar to the concept of the 0.08 BAC for alcohol. The most important thing that the research showed was there's no evidence that drivers definitely become impaired at one specific level, that some individuals with high blood alcohol THC may not be significantly impaired, while others with low levels may be severely affected. These limitations and uncertainties pose a serious challenge for law enforcement to identify and prosecute marijuana impaired drivers. We oppose this measure to legalize recreational marijuana use and recommend this committee oppose this. We have a genuine traffic safety concern. It has taken generations to educate the public about drinking and driving. And we probably, in the last year, we averaged probably about 10,000 deaths on our roads due to drinking and driving. Without solid measures in place to detect and prosecute for marijuana impaired driving, New Hampshire is not prepared for the potential increase in impaired driving and the devastation that accompanies it. Based on our research in Washington, we can assume that the availability and use of marijuana will increase, which will naturally lead to increases in drug driving and sadly, traffic deaths. More studies are needed before making such a far-reaching policy that could have unintended but tragic consequences to traffic safety. And that's it, I'm open to answering questions.
Thank you for your testimony. Questions to the committee? Seeing none, thank you.
Thank you.
And the chair calls Devon Cook to speak in favor of the vote. And you've indicated 5 minutes, I hope you can
do less.
Shorten that. Thank you.
A lot of people have already spoken some of my points. Thank you, Mr. Chairperson, and members of the committee. I'm here in support of the legalization bill. Not going to take up time and talk about statistics or potential benefits. I'm here as a recreational user of marijuana for probably, I'm 32 years old, so it's been probably the last 15 years. I own a car, I pay my bills, I have a job. But I've encountered some bumps in the road. I was arrested in 2013 for having $10 worth of marijuana in my vehicle during a traffic stop, which allowed me to, I could not get a job for quite some time after that because I am now a criminal according to the laws of New Hampshire for being in possession of marijuana. Maine and Massachusetts have recently legalized marijuana, and that puts a lot of stress on residents of New Hampshire as well as people who are recreational users in those states because, as someone mentioned earlier, there is a stretch between Massachusetts and Maine, 15 miles maybe, where it's New Hampshire. And if you want to travel between the two states to recreationally use marijuana, you have to travel through a state where you are now going to be arrested. And a lot of people don't realize it's a federal offense crossing the state lines in transporting marijuana. It's a federal offense. So we are actually pushing people to leave New Hampshire to go do what they want to do to recreationally enjoy marijuana in a state that's legal. And they are coming back into the state breaking federal law, which is a shame because if we had done what the West Coast has done and all the states in the area legalized, we wouldn't have that issue. There's a 1,300 mile stretch from California up to Washington where you can just drive and you can have marijuana in your car. You're not going to get in trouble because all the states there are legal to have marijuana in possession. And I think New Hampshire, we need to join, you know, we need to do the same thing. I consider myself more New Englander, you know, than a resident of New Hampshire. I was born in New Hampshire and I intend to die in New Hampshire, but in the meantime, not to use other people who have mentioned the motto of New Hampshire, live free or die, I'd like to live free in that time period. I'd like to continue to recreationally use marijuana, but in a responsible way, just like alcohol. If you were to purchase alcohol legally, you basically are agreeing to the terms and conditions to responsibly drink alcohol. And the same should be expected as a recreational marijuana user. If it is legal in the state, you are to use it in a way that doesn't affect anyone else. You're not to drive, you're not to be intoxicated, you're not to be high or whatever, driving around your car. You're to use it in a place in your home, in the privacy of your home, not in public, where you can do it in a responsible way. And you know, that is basically my main argument for legalization. You know, you drive to New Hampshire has, read on here, per capita alcohol consumption is nearly twice the national average in New Hampshire. You drive down the highways, you see liquor stores, state liquor stores everywhere. We like to drink in New Hampshire, you know? It is what it is, but quite a few people like to use marijuana as well. Not to demean the young lady that spoke about her Facebook poll, but there have been many other polls that have been taken across the state, and there's been a lot more of a control group than 2,000 people. Basically, majority of the state is ready for this bill to be passed. And Maine and Massachusetts had a lot of progressive-minded individuals that helped fulfill the ideals and the things that their constituents want. And I thank the House, I thank the members of the committee for performing their job admirably. This bill, the decriminalization bill, has passed through the House many times in the past. I would like to see the legalization bill get on the government's desk eventually. You know, people with the knowledge, people to start learning that there is nothing wrong. There is no stigma attached to people who are marijuana users. You know, we're not bad people. We just want to responsibly enjoy something in the privacy of our homes and not be bothered to exercise our rights as a New Hampshire resident to, like I said, live free and up. Like I said, a lot of people already spoke about some of the things I wanted to talk about, so I thank you for your time, and I also thank you for every advocate that is here representing me. I'm an average, ordinary resident of New Hampshire, a marijuana user, and I thank you all for your time coming here and fighting for the average person like myself. Thank you very much. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Seeing no questions. Chair will call Rick Nyer, speak in favor of the bill. And I can remind you that we've listed 3 minutes to speak. I know once you come to the mic, it's easy to get lost in and keep going on, but I just remind you that we did list times on the card, so appreciate your support.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. Thank you, committee, as well. Again, I'm Rick Nye from Concord, New Hampshire Normal, New Hampshire Hemp Investment Freedom Rally, New Hampshire Cannabis Company. I'm in favor of this bill after much ado and reading and going over it, and still discussing it with our peers in the rear here. And after listening to the testimonies today, especially from the police officer who was here, it really did send a heck of a message to me. You know, growing up in the 60s and watching the revolution, I'd have to thank you, the peaceful revolution, or the change of guards, and the changing of the ways. I think that's where we're at right now. I think that New Hampshire is at a crossroads that we need to step forward with. I think the fear-mongering that we were drilled throughout the years has really come to an educated, scientific basis, not biased by any stretch of the imagination, by whether it be a medical field or anybody that's warranting some type of study or another type of data and research to be done. I think it's important to know that the people have spoken. It really doesn't have anything to do with a child or a nurse or a doctor. It's just all of us have spoken. And we're asking you to do what's right for the citizens of New Hampshire, not specifically one group or a bias that you report again. I have 5 children, 2 through college, 2 up and coming. And things in my household, there aren't interests. We educate our children, and that's fundamentally what this bill has to offer, is not only generate revenue for the state and do it in a very controlled manner, but it also leaves room for education and giving children the opportunity to learn about it. Not only that, but we have to consider is the industry in itself is so large
that the jobs and technology for our children, we have some extremely talented children in our state that leave our state, don't come back, because they can't apply their technology to their skills here. Or maybe they got caught with a joint and they're not able to move on that way. By allowing a bill like this to move forward and legalizing cannabis in the state of New Hampshire, I think it'll open up the opportunities for not only our own state's citizens to invest in the industry, but our children to be invested for the future. We can't continue to give our resources and our finances to the opposite states that are surrounding us in New England. Our finances deserve to be here. We need to be investing in our future, and we need to do it with a bill like this one. It's very well thought out and planned. I think what we don't realize is the experts that we have in the background are speaking on behalf of all of you in hopes that you understand what we're doing is to make a newer and a better New Hampshire for our children. What we've been doing all these last number of years, and I'm a minority, by the way, you haven't heard me use the M word. I don't use that word. I use cannabis because that is its name. The other name that everybody uses is a racist term that was given. So I don't use that word. I think all of us should probably start considering don't use the M word and use the cannabis word. You'll be a lot more educated that way. And for all the kids that are here that might have friends that have fallen and they keep thinking the gateway and all of these things, these are choices that we make. Each and every one of us and our parents are fundamentally are the ones that give us those foundations. So please, when we look at this bill, you read this bill and review the bill, please consider that tens of thousands of hours and the multiple years and years of studies that we have done on the opposite side to have to revert to the new side, just like the police officer and his association, the doctors, and all of the affiliations throughout the nation and the world are trying to say something. And being the house of the primary, I think fundamentally, New Hampshire should be in the forefront of this, and we should be setting a tempo and leaving a true example where science outweighs hysteria, where science educates our children to make conscientious decisions for not only their future, but our own as adults. Because as we get older, you know, the young kids take care of us. So we need to set the groundwork down to educate our children to make the right choices. And by bringing a bill like this one forward, I think it's going to help New Hampshire move in like the rest of the region and become the live free and die state as we should. We should have that choice. We have been taking it away from our children, our state, for far too long. I think we should pass this bill. Thank you very much.
Questions to the committee? Let's see, none. The chair calls Patricia Tilley.
Good afternoon, Chair and Committee. My name is Patricia Tilley. I am here today on behalf of Commissioner Jeffrey Myers from the Department of Health and Human Services. The department is opposed to HB 656 because of the science that shows that increased availability and decreased perception of harm leads to increased youth use. And we know that increased availability of any substance, including marijuana or cannabis, increases youth use. Marijuana use among adolescents is harmful to developing brains, which also may cause a lifetime of negative health, education, and social effects. Marijuana use among pregnant women, which we have not heard about during this very long series of testimony today, is also associated with birth defects, low birth weight, and stillbirth, especially when used in combination with tobacco. Increased marijuana use is also associated with other public health and safety issues, such as childhood poisonings from edibles that are packaged in brightly colored packages and look like brownies and candies. And that has shown real increases in emergency department use in Colorado. There is real data and real science that shows that. So in closing, we believe that marijuana has an effect on the entire healthcare system and has negative health effects and social outcomes, and we urge the committee to consider these things in their deliberation. Thank you.
I have a question. Has DHS considered the impact of the legalization in Maine and Massachusetts on our department here?
I have not. We don't have any particular comments about that at this time, and we have not done those sorts of studies. We would look to other advocates in the field who have done more work in that area.
Thank you. Questions to the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Chair calls Garrett East. And he's listed Garrett East. Is he here? Robert? Is Garrett here? Okay. Chair will call Ann Perbonner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. I rise in support of this bill. I'm a former state rep in 2012. I'm a father of two. I do direct store delivery to retailers all over the New England region, delivering baked fresh goods. And from what I've noticed is it's really interesting to watch how people engage in their economic practices from one state to the other, the reasons they make their economic decisions. And a lot of it has to do with the New Hampshire advantage. And what we're going to see, if we don't take this issue seriously, people are going to decide that the New Hampshire advantage is not worth it when it comes to this issue, and they will start taking their dollars for fun, specifically for mind-altering substances, and they're going to take them to Mass and to Maine instead of in New Hampshire. They're going to decide that economically it's better to not take that risk and avoid jail time. And as the powers swing back and forth between the two parties, if we don't do something about our taxes and having to fill budget shortfalls, we may have an income tax come up if we don't have a way to address those issues. Stop. And that will be the end of my testimony. Thank you.
Thank you for your conscientiousness. Appreciate it. And the chair now calls Dover Y2Y. We're listed 2 to 3 minutes to speak.
When in reality, it has many dangerous consequences. So among the many dangerous health consequences of marijuana are some similar ones to tobacco, including lung damage and potential cancer. But marijuana contains higher levels of many dangerous toxins.
It can also cause many psychological problems such as panic attacks, anxiety, paranoia, and depression. Marijuana is also addictive, perhaps with less physical dependency as cigarettes, but the same or greater amount of mental dependency.
Many consequences can be especially detrimental to teens. The teen brain is still developing and can be very vulnerable to the effects of marijuana. According to the National Institute on Drug Abuse, marijuana use is associated with memory problems, difficulty thinking and problem solving, and a drop in IQ. Students who use marijuana are more likely to drop out of high school than those who don't use, and it leads to an overall reduced intellectual level. We are also concerned that the legalization will also undoubtedly increase the availability of the drug to minors. It's concerning to see that the current rates of marijuana by youth in New Hampshire as of 2015 are at a rate of 22% of New Hampshire high school students have used marijuana in the past 30 days. And this number will only increase if marijuana is legalized. Even though minors cannot purchase the drug, it will be more available to them. If 18 and 21-year-olds are able to purchase marijuana effortlessly, it's common sense that youth will have easier access to it as well. The effects of similar legislation in other states should also be taken into account before New Hampshire makes the decision to legalize marijuana. The Rocky Mountain high-intensity drug trafficking area has compiled data from the past 3 years since similar legislation has been passed in Colorado, and the numbers so far are very alarming. In just 3 years since the bill was passed, marijuana-related traffic deaths increased by 48%, and marijuana-related emergency room visits increased by 49%. But most concerning to our group is the fact that Colorado youth now rank number one in the nation for marijuana use, at 74% higher than the national average. We believe that if marijuana is legalized in New Hampshire, the numbers and the rates of youth use will increase similarly. As of right now, there is no need for New Hampshire to rush into this legislation. Many other states, including Colorado and Washington, and more recently our neighbors in Maine and Massachusetts, have all legalized marijuana. New Hampshire is in a perfect position right now to observe the effects of the legalization in these states in the next 5 to 10 years, and then wait to make the best possible decision for New Hampshire based on more data.
New Hampshire needs to take time to look beyond the two extremes in incarceration and legalization and develop a middle ground approach based on science and careful assessment of public health and safety.
For all of these reasons, we oppose and urge you to vote against House Bill 656. Thank you all for your time, and if there are any questions, we would be happy to answer them.
Representative Yeager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your excellent, all three of you, your excellent presentation. Pardon my voice, I'm getting scratchy. Have any studies been done by your group in regards to alcohol use amongst teenagers?
Yes.
Do you have
follow-up
results? Thank you.
We do not have those results with us.
You don't have those results?
Similar results can be found on the Dover Coalition for Youth website, but we don't have them with us currently.
Okay, thank you.
Chair has a question. As Dover is very close to the main line, have you also looked into the impact of legalization in Maine on your students there?
I don't believe that we have done any research into that yet.
Questions of the committee? See none? Thank you. Chair calls the final team card. Move on to Dave Thornton.
So I just wanted to speak really quickly as to my experience with DWI as I worked as a hospital security guard. So on occasion, we'll have police officers come in with suspects, and we'll have them take blood tests as they refuse to take our roadside test. So with regards to enforceability of DWI with regards to marijuana, we don't necessarily need to have a roadside test at this time to enforce the law. Thank you.
Thank you for testimony. Seeing no more pink cards, are anyone also wish to speak on 656? Submitted a card yet? Okay, I guess If you'd like to speak, please come down to the podium, speak, and then I'll have you fill out a big card upon your page. How long do you need to speak?
Three minutes. I filled out two pink cards. And I passed on one of them.
Did you say you have a pink card that's already been turned in?
I turned one in, I turned two in, and I passed, like when you asked me to speak, I passed on one.
Okay, proceed. After you finish, you can check with us.
So, waiting for more authoritative data on legalizing marijuana may be attractive and wait for other states to see what they're doing, but it will not stop use in the state of New Hampshire, and it won't stop abuse. But it will stop New Hampshire from implementing a reasonable and sensible education program. Some drugs should not be used by all citizens of New Hampshire. For example, I am allergic to penicillin and codeine, which I know because I had serious reactions to them. And if I take one of them again, I may die from it. But that doesn't mean you or you should never have access to codeine or penicillin, a life-saving antibiotic. And the same for alcohol consumption. Some people, either due to their genetic makeup, or they've used it, or they have some other problem with their liver and metabolizing alcohol, they can't use alcohol. But we have places to buy alcohol all over the state, and hopefully we have ways to manage that consumption and to educate people or to help people if they're abusing it. There are presently several drugs that are FDA approved that mimic cannabinoids. There's a reason, you know, they work, they help people. Regarding marijuana as a gateway drug, I know when I was in college in the early 70s, I had ample access to stimulants, to barbiturates, to magic mushrooms, to LSD. I never used any of them. I did use marijuana then, and alcohol, and alcohol makes me sick, so why use it? But I know many individuals who were also marijuana users way back when, and they are currently gainfully employed individuals. They're lawyers, doctors, professors, nurses, property owners, taxpayers. It's not just people who unfortunately aren't as productive as they might be. Regarding Colorado State Patrol statistics, just this morning, and I see different numbers, and these are produced by the government of the state of Colorado, where 2011 there were 546 fatalities. I won't read you every year, but in 2016 there were 540 fatalities. So using those statistics, we're not seeing, well, I don't know what we're seeing, because we don't always know what we're getting. People are asking more, people are being tested more for marijuana or other drugs when there is an accident. So those indications are going to be higher based on the change in reporting. And there's also, for example, in Colorado, there's more use reported. It's legal now, so people may be more comfortable saying they use it. There's more out-of-state users. There's more first-time users. More miles driven, more cars, more driver's licenses. So there's a lot more people driving and getting in accidents. And I've never suggested somebody should drive while high on marijuana or any other drug that they don't know that they can't handle when they're driving. However, I do know that I would be much safer with somebody who is driving under the influence of marijuana than alcohol. Somebody who uses marijuana may drive so slow, you know, run off the road, or they'll stop somewhere and eat and they'll fall asleep. And that doesn't happen with alcohol to the same extent. But I'd like to speak more directly to the bill under discussion. I had a couple suggestions that I thought could make it better as implemented, which would be to encourage retail establishments to sell microdose products. One of the problems that happened in Colorado that was making the news widely was that people, you might call them naive users, people who hadn't used cannabis before, they would buy one of these candies and eat it and do all kinds of bad things to themselves or their home or their, you know, walk off a car parking garage, I think somebody got hurt that way. Naive user, high dose. So what I'd recommend is some encouragement if or when a marijuana law gets implemented in New Hampshire, that the state encourage low dose, not just labeling, like you might have something in even in a medical dispensary that says, you know, make four doses out of this, and maybe 40 milligrams of THC, and they recommend having 10 milligrams as a dose. If you buy, if you're prescribed THC from a physician, it's standardized, the pills, 2.5 milligrams of THC, 5 milligrams of THC, or 10 milligrams of THC. So it would be easier for people to not overdose or overuse it if things were produced in less dosage of a product. I had on other occasions talked to a couple managers of medical cannabis dispensaries and asked them, you know, like if they're selling chocolate, why don't they just sell the same flavored chocolate not with cannabis in it? Because if people want more, you know, they've only got a little tiny piece, and that's all they can have for 3-4 hours. So if, and they both, the managers, would like to sell it, but people aren't producing it, and it, the state could encourage it. That's all I'm suggesting. Page 5, line 3, the bill mentions extraction methods that would be not allowed for consumers to use, and those restrictions may be in there to try to stop people from using extraction methods that may be combustible, and I can completely agree with it and appreciate that. But the way the language is written, it will also stop people from putting some marijuana leaves in some butter or some olive oil, because it only allows for marijuana extraction from water or vegetable glycerin. And I just think the wording could be changed to allow for something else. Section, page 7, there's a section on safety inserts. It talks about all marijuana, medicine, cannabis, I'm not sure. Products shall include warning labels such as the product has intoxicating effects. There's a very large increase in desire for products that only have CBD, which is just one of the cannabinoids, and somebody who wants that may be a medical marijuana user in the state of New Hampshire, but maybe they don't have the money to go through to find the doctor, or maybe they're not medically qualified. People don't get high from CBD, and there may be other cannabinoids that people don't get that psychoactive effect from, so I think some relaxation in the labeling for products that don't have psychoactive would be helpful. Legalizing marijuana in New Hampshire does not mean it will end up with all the storefronts like exist in Colorado. That's probably a bit much. I've heard about it. I haven't seen it. Continuing with the current laws in New Hampshire does do some harm to New Hampshire citizens. It does affect our police force being able to do other things. Legalizing marijuana or relaxing the laws in New Hampshire may attract new residents. New Hampshire is one of the aging states, one of them.
Chairman, remind you also that we try not to be redundant of saying testimony we've heard a few times over.
Sensible legislation could help increase revenues and have people move. Thank you.
Questions to the committee? Seeing none, thank you. Okay, we have any other pink cards? Seeing no other? So you can go to the pink cards, but do you
I am. I'll keep this brief. Thank you.
Unless you didn't indicate the time you need to speak. How much time do you need?
About 15 seconds, if you'll allow me.
Sounds great. Go ahead.
My name is James Potter, for the record. I am Executive Vice President for the New Hampshire Medical Society. In brief, I'm not going to repeat the testimony, but we stand in opposition to House Bill 656. and urge you to vote inexpedient to legislate. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other testimony on House Bill 656-FN? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing on 656.